All right, good morning, everybody. Let's get started again. Hope everybody had a nice weekend. I believe that Professor Haydock left class on Friday kind of in this general area. Is this correct? SP mixing? Okay, we were talking about homonuclear diatomic molecules, the molecular orbital diagrams of these molecules. And one of the nuances of looking at the homonuclear diatomics is this idea about orbital mixing. And in this case, for the second row diatomics, lithium through neon, we're talking about SP mixing because we're looking at S orbitals and P orbitals as the valence orbitals in these molecules. And probably he left on this slide where we're looking from lithium here going to beryllium, boron, et cetera, all the way to neon, and looking at the molecular orbital picture for each of these different homonuclear diatomics. And these are the energy levels for the S and the P molecular orbitals. And what we can see is there's a systematic trend as we march across from left to right in the periodic table. We see that all of the energies for all of the orbitals decrease. And that's because we have an increasing nuclear charge as we march across from left to right. So the effective nuclear charge, the so-called Z effective, increases as we go from left to right. That draws the S orbitals down more in energy than the P orbitals because the S orbitals are less shielded. They're closer to the nucleus, so electrons there feel the effective nuclear charge more strongly. And so you get an increasing split in the energy between the S orbitals and the P orbitals as we go from the left to the right. That has an important consequence for SP mixing, because remember, in order for orbitals to mix and to create bonding and antibonding combinations, they have to be close in energy. So the farther away they are in energy, the weaker and weaker this SP mixing phenomenon is going to be. So on the left-hand side here, we have a small energy difference comparatively between the S and the P orbitals. And so we have a fairly large SP mixing. And what that means is that it's going to push the orbitals that are of the same symmetry down and up in energy. And that means, in particular for us, that this orbital here that's composed of the PZ, this is a sigma-type orbital, is pushed above the pi-type orbitals for these molecules all the way until we get to nitrogen. Okay. Nitrogen still has the sigma orbital above the pi orbitals, but when we move to oxygen, the SP mixing becomes sufficiently weak that this orbital is not pushed as strongly upward in energy, and it falls actually below the pi orbitals. And so we see a switch in the order here between nitrogen and oxygen. Okay. And so anything from oxygen over, these three homonuclear diatomics, have very weak SP mixing, and so we have the sigma below the pi's. And for anything nitrogen and to the left, we have the sigma orbital above the pi's. Okay? And this, of course, has a profound consequence on how we fill electrons in the molecular orbital picture. Okay? And it will dictate, for example, why oxygen has two unpaired electrons and why it's paraelectric, paramagnetic, rather than diamagnetic. Okay? So this concept of orbital mixing is something that we're going to come back to time and again. We're going to see it kind of as a slight change in all of the molecular orbital diagrams that we build. We'll build the diagram, and then in the end, what we'll do is we'll consider the effect of orbital mixing. That's going to push lower orbitals that have the same symmetry down, and it's going to push the upper orbitals that have the symmetry up in energy. A little bit more bonding and a little bit more antibonding character is essentially what's happening. Okay? And so this just kind of summarizes the idea of SP mixing in the homonuclear diatomics. For these five homonuclear diatomics, we have this situation where the sigma is above the pi's. And for the other three, we have the sigma below the pi's. Okay. All right. So one important thing that we can immediately understand from molecular orbital diagrams is the bond order. Right? So we can pick out how many bonding electrons, how many antibonding electrons we have in these simple molecules. And we can determine the bond order. It turns out that the bond order is the main thing that's important in understanding the bond length in these sorts of simple molecules. So this is a nice picture from partly from your book of bond distance in picometers versus valence electrons, but basically it's versus the kind of homonuclear diatomic we have. In the blue, we have just the neutrals, boron, carbon, nitrogen 2, oxygen 2, and fluorine. And using the molecular orbital diagrams, we can fill the electron configuration up, and we can determine, for example, that boron has a bond order of 1. It looks like it also has the longest bond length. Right? As we increase the bond order, we go to carbon 2. That's a bond order of 2. Okay? That's a substantially smaller bond length. Nitrogen has the shortest bond length because it has a bond order of 3. And then as we go the other direction here and we start filling antibonding orbitals, okay, oxygen has a bond order of 2, fluorine has 1 of 1. Okay? And so the bond length correspondingly increases and we get this nice kind of V or U shape. We can also look at some of the charged homonuclear diatomics. So here's an example of nitrogen that's been positively charged, pulled 1 electron out of the nitrogen bonding orbital, and that gives us a bond order of 2.5 instead of 3. Okay. If we take oxygen, which is here, right, and we add, we take another electron away, then we're going to have a bond order of 2.5 because we've removed an electron from an antibonding orbital in the case of oxygen. And so forth. And so as we see, these intermediate bond orders, 2.5, have intermediate bond lengths between a bond order of 3 and 2. And so it's a very, very good solid trend. We can look at the bond order with our simple molecular orbital diagram picture, and we can guess sort of the relative ordering of the bond lengths in these simple molecules. Okay. Here's a couple of other examples. Carbon with 2 negative charges on it, oxygen that's gained an electron. So it has very little to do with the size of the, you know, the covalent size of the atom. It has much more to do with the strength of the bond. Okay, the stronger bonds are going to pull the two nuclei closer together. Your book talks pretty extensively about that, so if you want more information, you can take a look. Let's now go from homonuclear diatomics to diatomics that are heteronuclear, okay, two different atoms. When we start talking about these more complicated molecules, you start using different atoms and combining them together, it's important that we understand what the relative energies are of the atomic orbitals that we start with. Okay? And this is a very nice diagram showing the potential energy of the orbitals for the first 18 elements. Okay? So atomic number is along the bottom here. And what we see is we have a plot for the potential energy for the 1s's, the 2s's, the 2p's, the 3s's, and then the 3p's. Okay? And with this kind of information, this is also tabulated in your book, you can understand immediately what the most significant interactions are likely to be in a molecule. Remember, hopefully, Professor Haydock talked about the idea that if you have an energy difference greater than some range, like around 12 or 14 electron volts, that the interaction between orbitals is going to be very small or zero, okay, close to zero. And so we can tell from this diagram right here when we expect to have very, very small orbital interactions, essentially no overlap, and when we expect to have reasonable bonding and antibonding interactions. You can see this trend that we showed for the sp mixing play out here in the 2s and the 2p orbitals. As we go across from left to right in the periodic table, the s orbitals decrease in energy faster than the p orbitals do. And again, that's because of shielding. Okay? And the effective nuclear charge for the s electrons being larger than that for the p electrons. Okay? So we see the same thing repeat to a lesser degree, perhaps, between the 3s and the 3p orbitals. So let's start building heteronuclear diatomics. Let's start with a fairly straightforward example, kind of an extreme example. We're going to look at HF. Okay? Let me actually back up a second and state exactly where these numbers come from. Okay? How do people actually experimentally determine these numbers? One of the ways of doing this is called photoelectron spectroscopy. And that's what's indicated up here, photoelectron spectroscopy. This is a technique where you shine light at a material, or in this case, a gas of atoms, for example, a gas of molecules. And that light is of sufficient energy to eject electrons from the material. Okay? And then you detect the kinetic energy of those electrons. You know the incident energy of the photons. You know the kinetic energy of the electrons. And so you can back out what the binding energy must have been for those electrons. And the binding energy gives us a pretty good idea about what the potential energy is of the different orbitals. So if we do that for hydrogen, for example, we're going to eject a hydrogen electron once we have 13.6 electron volts of energy. That's the binding energy for that 1s electron in hydrogen. Okay. So this is one way in which we can get, photoelectron spectroscopy is one way in which we can get these sorts of numbers. Let's look at hydrogen fluoride, HF. When we look at hydrogen fluoride, what we want to do is first consider the valence orbital energies. Okay. Hydrogen is simple. It's 13.6. That's 1 Rydberg, if you remember from general chemistry. In fluorine, we have to consider the 2s and the 2p, because those are the valence orbitals for fluorine. The fluorine 2s is way deep in energy, 40 electron volts. And the fluorine 2p is about 19 electron volts. Okay? And so right now, we can say right away, just by looking at this, the difference between the 1s's in hydrogen and the 2s's in fluorine is way too large for there to be any real interaction between them. Okay? The interaction in hydrogen and fluoride is going to be between the 1s of hydrogen and the 2p's of the fluorine. And we can state that kind of right away. Let's see how we can build a molecular orbital diagram using hydrogen fluoride. OK, so this is just what I said there. The 1s orbital of hydrogen is the only one we need to consider. So this is a nice simple example because we're using hydrogen. It's not going to interact with the 2s's of fluorine because they're too deep in energy, but it is probably going to interact with the 2p's of fluorine. Okay? In particular, we can guess right away that the 1s is going to make a sigma type interaction with the 2pz of the fluorine. Okay? So let's build our molecular orbital diagram, which we can kind of just do by inspection or just by thinking about it. We don't need to have any formal approach. What we're normally going to do here is we're going to put, you know, one atom on one side of the diagram, the other atom on the other side. Here's our potential energy scale. Here's our 1s orbital that we care about for hydrogen. Here's where fluorine's going to lie. This is not really totally to scale, but you get the idea. This should be a little bit lower than the 1s, and this should be way lower than the 1s of the hydrogen. Okay. So, of course, the number of valence electrons we need to worry about, there's going to be one here, and there's going to be seven for the fluorine coming in, right? So we have eight total valence electrons we need to care about. So we'll get to that in a bit. Let's think about the interactions that we can have. Well, the first thing is that the 2s orbital is so deep that it's not going to interact with anything. We just bring that directly across, unchanged in energy in the diagram when we make the HF molecule, and we paint the molecular orbital is just a single S lobe on the fluorine and nothing, no contribution from the hydrogen. Okay, that's one way to draw that. Okay, so if you see nothing at the other end of the bond stick here, that means that there's no orbital contribution from hydrogen, purely on fluorine. And because it has essentially zero interaction with the 1s, it's a non-bonding orbital, NB. A non-bonding orbital. Just comes straight across and plops right in the middle of the diagram. Okay. So our consideration of the 2s is finished. Okay? Now what we need to do is think about the possible interactions between the 1s and the 2p's. These are close enough in energy now to interact. The question is, do they have the right symmetry to interact? Okay? And of course they do. We know this because we can just imagine the 1s interacting with the 2pz, and we're going to make a bonding and an anti-bonding combination. Okay? So how are we painting these? Okay? Here's the orbital shape. Just with our simple shading diagram. This is the 2pz we're just going to call the internuclear axis, the z-axis. And we have the hydrogen coming in with its 1s. We have the 2pz coming in to make a bonding interaction where we have both positive lobes interacting like this. Okay? There should be a slightly more character in this molecular orbital of the fluorine than from the hydrogen. Okay? And so we indicate that. It's not indicated too well, but the size of this P orbital here should be bigger when taken all together than this S orbital. Okay? So we indicate that more of the electron density is going to reside on the fluorine in this case than will on the hydrogen, okay, if this orbital is occupied. That's going to be a sigma bonding type orbital. And of course, then we have the antibonding pair, right? And this is going to be where we have the, in this case, the lobe, the signs of the PZ orbital flipped. It doesn't matter whether we change the S orbital sign or the P orbital sign. It's the same thing, right? The important thing is that we have a positive, let's say, and then a negative. So this interaction is antibonding between the two nuclei. Okay? We're going to call that sigma because it's a sigma type bond with no node along the internuclear axis. And it's a sigma star because it's an antibonding combination. What about the other two orbitals? So right now we've got these four orbitals, we've got this one, so we should have five total molecular orbitals, right? And we have three so far, so we have two molecular orbitals that we have not yet built. Where do those come from? Well, those must be the PY and the PX coming in from the fluorine, right? Because we've accounted for the PZ. The PY and the PX are the other two in that 2P manifold. They do not have any bonding interactions at all with the 1s, right? Because they have perfect zero overlap by symmetry. And so these PY and PX are just going to come straight over as non-bonding P orbitals that look like this. There's no contribution from hydrogen in either one of them. There's only contribution from fluorine. In this case, let's call that the PY and let's call that the PX. Okay? And so we have 5 atomic orbitals. We have 5 molecular orbitals. And we are basically done building the molecular orbital diagram for HF. Let's see what it tells us. Okay, so now let's fill in the molecular orbitals with electrons. We have 8 electrons total. Right, we have 1 from the hydrogen, and we have 7 from the fluorine. We fill just using the off-ball principle from the bottom up. Okay. So when we fill them in, there's our 8 electrons. So let's see what we've learned. And let's see in particular how the molecular orbital information correlates, how does it agree with the simple Lewis dot type diagram that we're familiar with for HF. Okay. So we've got 2 electrons in a non-bonding here. We've got 1 bonding molecular orbital filled, and then we have 2 more non-bonding molecular orbital filled. Okay. Let's look at the character of the filled orbitals. This one is purely on fluorine. Okay. These 2 here are purely on fluorine with no hydrogen component. So those are 3 lone pairs on fluorine, okay, which is what we would expect from the Lewis dot diagram. And we have 1 sigma type bonding interaction, with most of the electron density in that bond between hydrogen and fluorine located close to the fluorine. And that should make a lot of sense because fluorine is a highly electronegative element, right? So it's going to pull a lot of the electron density close to itself. In this particular example, it agrees very nicely with the Lewis dot diagram that we have 6 electrons fully on fluorine and these 2 bonding electrons mostly on fluorine. Okay? And so you remember if you drew the Lewis dot diagram, you'd have H bond to F and 3 lone pairs on F. Okay? Interestingly here, and this is where there's a bit more reality to this picture than in the Lewis dot diagram, when you draw the Lewis dot diagram, you have 3 lone pairs on fluorine. It assumes or it implies that all 3 of those lone pairs are the same, right? But the molecular orbital picture tells you that those 3 lone pairs are not the same. There's 1 lone pair that's way deep in energy down here. And there's 2 lone pairs that are equivalent, much higher in energy. Okay? So we'll see that there's a lot more nuance complexity that comes out just very simply out of the molecular orbital picture that you can't get by just drawing a very simple Lewis dot diagram. Any questions about our hydrogen fluoride example? This is a nice example because we have hydrogen, so we only have 1s orbital to worry about on 1 of the partners, and we have a very large electronegativity difference between the 2 atoms. You can read that directly off the table just by looking at the relative energies of these orbitals versus the 1s orbital. The more electronegative elements are going to be deeper, they're going to have deeper lying atomic orbitals. Okay, so if there are no questions, let's go to our second 2-atom heteronuclear example. So let's look at, for example, carbon monoxide. Okay. Carbon monoxide is a very nice and a very important, it turns out, 2-atom example for molecular orbital diagram building. We're going to use carbon monoxide as a ligand for metals later in the class, and so this is going to tell us why carbon monoxide bonds to metals the way it does. Okay, that's kind of one of the important lessons we're going to get out from our molecular orbital diagram that we're going to generate here in the next couple slides. First step, if we consider carbon monoxide, is we need to think about the different atomic orbital energies. So we've got the 2s's for carbon and oxygen there, and we've got the 2p's for carbon and oxygen there. So you can tell right away, of course, we're going to have 8 atomic orbitals that we need to worry about. 4 from oxygen, 4 from carbon. And those on oxygen are deeper in energy than those on carbon. So the diagram that we're going to build is essentially the same as a homonuclear diagram, except it's tilted. Okay? It's tilted because one element, in this case, has a larger electronegativity than the other one. And so it's going to be slanted toward oxygen, in a sense. We can also tell a little bit straight off the bat. So this orbital here, the 2p, is not going to interact very strongly with the oxygen 2s because the energy difference is large. Okay? But the other 3 are pretty similar in energy, and so we expect strong interactions between these 3 and weak interactions between with the 2s on oxygen. Okay? So let's see how this plays out. Again, we can do this mostly by just inspection. It's just a little bit more complicated because we have 3 additional atomic orbitals to worry about. Okay. So here's carbon. Carbon has 4 valence electrons. And here's oxygen. Oxygen, of course, has 6 valence electrons. It's just qualitative, so I've drawn the oxygen deeper in energy. Okay, it's not drawn perfectly to scale, but you could do that if you wanted to. The notation here, just to keep track of things, I probably should change this, but this is 2s of atom A, 2p of atom A, this is atom A, and this is 2p of atom B, 2s of atom B. Okay? You can label it any way you want. So let's look at our interactions now. Okay, the 2s of carbon and the 2s of oxygen are close enough in energy to interact, and of course they have the same symmetries, so they're going to make sigma bonds and antibonds. So what we do is we form our molecule. You may remember that carbon monoxide is a triple bond, right? Which we should be able to extract out of the molecular orbital diagram once we're finished with it. We draw our sigma bonding orbital, okay? And in this case, we're just going to choose randomly. The shading is going to be the same, and it's going to be clear shading here. The lobe on the oxygen is going to be larger than the lobe on the carbon because the oxygen contributes more to this molecular orbital than does the carbon. It's closer in energy to the molecular orbital. It's lower in energy to start with. So the bonding orbital is going to be mostly oxygen. Okay. That means that the antibonding orbital should be the reverse. That character of this antibonding sigma orbital is going to be mostly on the carbon. Okay. Carbon provides a larger coefficient when its modulus square is taken than does the oxygen. Okay. And hopefully you can see we have a bonding and an antibonding sigma. Okay, let's look at some of the other interactions. Here's the interaction that is between the two PZs of the oxygen and of the carbon. Okay? Now this one looks a little weird because I haven't drawn, just to keep it simple, I haven't drawn a couple of extra lines in here, but let's explain what's going on here. We have a bonding combination and an antibonding combination. The bonding combination is where you take, you know, one P orbital that is, let's say, positive polarity, and we subtract another one so that we have the same sign along the internuclear axis. That gives us the bonding. The antibonding is where they have the same polarity. So in between, they have a positive and a negative, let's say, and that's the antibonding situation. These are both sigma type, okay? It's easy to understand why this one goes high, okay? So it should go higher than the highest atomic orbital. But what's going on with this one? Why isn't this molecular orbital deeper than the two P's of oxygen? It's because this molecular orbital here has composition from both the 2P and the 2s of carbon. So it's like two atomic orbitals from carbon interacting with one atomic orbital from oxygen. And so that kind of pushes this molecular orbital up, and actually it's a little bit higher in energy than the original energies of the 2p's on oxygen. Okay. So this lobe diagram here has a larger contribution from carbon than it does oxygen because the carbon's got two orbitals that are interacting with the one orbital from oxygen. The antibonding orbital is also mostly carbon. You can see it's slightly larger carbon lobe than oxygen lobe. And that makes sense just from our normal picture of these atomic orbitals being closer in energy to the antibonding molecular orbital. So I should really have drawn extra lines in here from the 2s to this. So there would be two lines coming into this molecular orbital from carbon and only one from oxygen. But I didn't want to get too many lines in the diagram. Okay, so we've looked at our sigma orbitals. That's always the place to start, right? We do sigma orbitals first, then let's do our pi orbitals. Pi orbitals, we have, of course, the pys and the px's coming in from both elements. They can make good bonding and antibonding combinations. They're fairly close in energy. And so we're going to have two bonding pi orbitals coming down. Let's call these the pys and these the px's, okay? And we're going to have the antibonding combinations of the pys and the px's. So these, of course, have the same sign on either side of the internuclear axis, and these have different signs on either side of the internuclear axis. That gives us an antibonding combination, okay, for the higher energy orbitals here. The split, you know, for the pi's, is going to be smaller in general than for the sigmas, again, because the overlap is smaller. And so that's why these two orbitals here don't rise above this one. They're not up here, they're down here because of the S for these being a little bit tinier than for the sigma orbitals. Okay. What else to say? The lobes, right? These lobes here of the oxygens are slightly larger than carbon because for the bonding combinations, they're closer in energy to the original oxygens. Okay? And the reverse for the antibonding combinations.
So on the sigma bonds between the 2p piece. The sigma bonding orbital.
This one here?
Yeah.
Yep.
So we said it has more, the lobes are larger on the carbon because it's more like the carbon, but it is closer in energy to the oxygen.
So the idea here is that this orbital in particular, this sigma orbital, has contributions from two different carbon atomic orbitals and only one oxygen atomic orbital. And so if you look at its overall character, if you calculated its wave function, you'd find that the coefficients coming from carbon add up to be larger than the coefficients coming from oxygen. And so it's true that the way I've drawn this, this orbital here is closer in energy to the original atomic orbitals for the oxygen. But the reason that it's still carbon-based is because we have both 2p, z, and 2s character from carbon coming in. This illustrates a nice point. When we start having more complicated diagrams, it becomes quite ambiguous in many cases to understand exactly what kind of character an intermediate orbital has. Okay? If it has contributions from multiple different atoms, it gets pushed up, it gets pushed down, you know, yada, yada, yada. What happens to it at the end? You know, how do we characterize it? We can no longer often characterize it as a really, you know, true bonding or anti-bonding orbital. It's some combination of, you know, partially bonding, mostly anti-bonding. These are the sorts of descriptors that we have to use, okay? In these cases, especially where we have molecular orbitals sort of in the middle of a fairly complicated diagram. This is a limitation of our qualitative approach. If we wanted to be more quantitative, we could get, you know, more correct sizings for the different lobes and so forth that could give us a much better idea. And if you actually do a real calculation, you find that most of this particular orbital is on the carbon. And that's actually vital to understand the chemistry of carbon monoxide, so we'll get to that in a second. Okay, so I believe the next step here is to fill up our molecular orbital picture. Okay, so at that point we're done, right? Let's back up a second here. We have four atomic orbitals plus four atomic orbitals, so we better have eight molecular orbitals. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And so we've accounted for everything. And this is the basic picture for carbon monoxide. Okay, so let's fill the electrons in. So we better have 10 valence electrons. So we've got 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. Okay. Now, what can we learn about the chemistry of CO from looking at this molecular orbital diagram? Well, one of the most important things is that the highest occupied molecular orbital, which is called the HOMO, the highest occupied molecular orbital, is located on carbon mostly. Remember, we said that this orbital here has got contributions from both the 2p and the 2s. So it's mostly got a lobe on carbon. So this is an important fact because those electrons are going to be the most reactive, right? If CO is oxidized, or if you give up some electrons from CO, that's where the electrons are going to come from, okay? The highest energy electrons in the molecule. Interestingly, if we look at these molecular orbitals here, the ones that are immediately above the filled one, we call these the LUMO, okay, the lowest unoccupied molecular orbital. Okay? So we've got the highest occupied molecular orbital, lowest unoccupied molecular orbital. These LUMO orbitals are also on carbon primarily. So this means that if the molecule were to accept electrons from somewhere, the electrons would reside on carbon primarily. If it were to give up electrons, the electrons would be lost primarily from carbon. In other words, the carbon end of CO is the business end of this molecule. Okay? If it does any chemistry, it's going to be doing it carbon head first. Okay? And the oxygen is just kind of along for the ride. What else can we learn? One thing that I should point out here is the number of bonds, right, in this particular molecule. So carbon monoxide, we expect to have three bonds, bond order of three. So how many bonds do we have? We have one bond. We have two, three, four. Okay, but this bond is basically on oxygen. Okay, and this is an antibond. So we have basically these two and this one as bonding orbitals. So we have three bonding molecular orbitals, and then we have the rest sort of canceling out. Okay, so we get our bond order of three. Okay. Any questions about our CO example? Yeah.
Just a general question. What was the energy gap that makes the atomic orbital interactions forbidden?
So The question is, you know, at what energy separation do you have basically zero interaction? So this is a range. You know, we prefer to state it as sort of a range because there's no hard rule. But the rule of thumb is something between, say, 12 and 14 electron volts. If it's larger than that, then there's going to be a very small to zero interaction. But it really depends on, you know, details in the molecule. But that's the kind of vague cutoff. Yeah. Other questions? Yeah.
So here, carbon is less electronegative. Does this follow a trend in which atoms that are less electronegative will have that, I guess, priority, electroorbital?
It depends on how the orbitals are filled, right? So in this case, we have a particular number of valence electrons that dictate where the HOMO and the LUMO lie. We could have the same molecular orbital picture, generally speaking, but if we only had 8 valence electrons, then the picture would be quite different, right? Then we'd be, this would be the HOMO, and this would be the LUMO. So then we've got this one being mostly on oxygen, that would be the HOMO, and the LUMO being mostly on carbon, right? So you're right that generally, when you build the diagram for this sort of small offset electronegativity difference between two elements, you're going to have this sort of diagram. But it really depends on how you fill it up, right? How many valence electrons you've got. Yep. Yeah, in the back.
So is it the symmetry of the 2s off carbon
and 2p carbon that makes it so that it influences the sigma? Yeah, that's right. So, you know, you're asking basically why does this orbital have contributions from both the 2s and the 2p of carbon?
Yeah, rather, yep. Why is it the sigma rather than the pi?
Uh-huh, yep. That's because if you think about the s orbital coming in, it can only make interactions with the pz orbital. It could make a sigma-type interaction. If you have, you know, an orthogonal p orbital, you have zero overlap, right? And so always the s orbital is not going to play at all with the px and the py, right? It's only the pz. And then you also, on carbon, have a second orbital that can interact with the pz, and that's the pz on carbon, right? So you have the pz on carbon, you have the s on carbon, both able to make sigma-type contributions with the PZ on oxygen. Yep. Yep. And so, yeah, it's very clear in the simpler molecules, you know, symmetry rules. So if the symmetry of the orbitals is different, there's no interaction. If the symmetry is the same, then the question is, are the energies sufficiently similar that you can actually get significant interactions? If the energies are similar, and again, within 12 to 14 electron volts approximately, then you expect to see some bonding and antibonding flavor. Yeah. Any other questions? I saw another hand. Yep.
How do you know the HOMO is on the carbon? Because actually it's closer to oxygen than carbon.
Yep. So this is similar to a question that was asked before. How do we know that this orbital here is mostly carbon-based? Because it looks like it's very close to the oxygen 2p's, right? And in fact, the way I've drawn it, it is close to the oxygen 2p's. The idea is that this orbital, we have to consider where it comes from. And it comes from a combination of 2pz and 2s from carbon. So you can think of it as two orbitals from carbon interacting with one orbital from oxygen. And so because the energies are fairly similar here, they all interact fairly reasonably, we have more carbon character than oxygen character because of the 2 versus 1. Contribution. Yep. In your book, there's a very nice, you know, the actual calculations. And calculations of this particular molecular orbital you should look at, it's got a big fat lobe that sits on carbon. Okay. Other questions? Yeah. Oh, yeah. Okay, so you're talking about comparing the homonuclear diatomic diagram with this one and understanding why we have this arrangement versus the opposite arrangement. Is that what you mean? Okay, yeah. So here, what dictates that is not so much sp mixing. I mean, this is basically sp mixing, right? We've got s mixing with p from the carbon and contributing to a p orbital on oxygen to make a molecular orbital. So this is basically the same idea. It's just kind of in a different got a slightly different look to it. The difference is that when you have homonuclear diatomics, they all have the same energy, right? The p orbitals, the s orbitals have the same energy. Right? And then you're just talking about the energy difference between the p and the s orbitals, period. It's just on the same element, the same atom. Here, what we care about is how much electronegativity difference we have, you know, what the relative atomic orbital energies are to start with. That's going to tell us how much sp mixing is possible from these two and this one, for example. Let's say that this orbital, this atomic orbital, is much deeper in energy for some reason. Okay? Then the sp mixing coming from this side would be much weaker with the p's over here. And basically, you just have a p-p interaction. And that would then certainly lead to a lowering of this orbital. Okay? It would be much lower and probably lower than the pi orbitals. So, you know, for the homonuclear diatomics, we looked at just the amount of sp mixing that is dictated by the energy difference between the p and the s's. Here we have to consider the energy differences between the p and the s's of two different atoms. Possibly, yeah. Yeah, that's possible. Yep. Yeah, so the details depend, or the result here depends on the details of exactly, you know, what the energy difference is here relative to these guys. That dictates most of the picture. But it is not necessarily straightforward to, you know, guess where this orbital is going to be exactly. Right? So again, this gets to the fact that when we start having different elements coming in and the diagrams get a little bit complicated, especially the orbitals in the middle of the diagram, it's not necessarily easy to order them, right, in increasing energy. Right? There's some ambiguity there. So that's why having a real calculation can be critical. Okay, let's move on. Okay, so we can summarize what we've done so far. We've introduced linear combination atomic orbital molecular orbital theory as just a simple method for predicting, again, this is an approximation of the electronic structure of molecules. Okay, we remember that we have to have the same symmetry for atomic orbitals to interact to make bonding and antibonding combinations, and they have to have similar energy. We get the energies of the atomic orbitals from methods like photoelectron spectroscopy. There's, of course, other ways to get these numbers too. And what we want to do now is see how we can build up larger molecules, more complicated molecules, using this general framework. So what we're first going to do is we're going to continue to look at linear molecules, but we're going to have three atoms. Okay? And then we're going to start looking at bent molecules and more complicated cases. Okay, so here's the main event for today, starting a little bit late, but we're good. Linear and bent molecules. This is sort of in the middle of chapter 5 now. Okay, there is a formalized procedure that we can follow that relies very strongly on our understanding of symmetry and our use of character tables to determine the molecular orbital pictures for more complicated molecules. This is what we would do if we wanted to go through the entire formalized procedure. The first thing that we want to do, as always, is determine the point group of the molecule that we're talking about. Point groups, everybody's like, oh, point groups. If we have a linear molecule, you remember that we have two possibilities, right? D infinity H, C infinity V. We don't need these infinite rotational axes in order to determine the symmetry of molecular orbitals. So what we do is we descend in symmetry and use simpler character tables that still capture the full symmetry of the orbitals. So if we have a D infinity H, we use a D2H, and if we have a C infinity V, we use a C2V. Those have all the symmetry operations necessary to distinguish between the different atomic orbital symmetries. And that's why we do that. We don't want to work with infinite numbers of symmetry operations. We'd be here for a while. Okay. Next, what we do, we assign our axes. And we assign axes for each individual element. Okay. Z is going to be the principal axis. This will be our convention. Okay. This is something that we followed every time up till now. If the molecule is nonlinear, point the y-axis at the central atom. Okay. So the outer atoms, Cartesian coordinates, point their y-axis at the central atom. That will give us a consistent formalism. Okay. Then what we want to do is we want to find the characters of the reducible representation for the outer atoms, for each individually for each kind of orbital, for the s orbital, the 2pz's, the 2px's, the 2py's, we want to build a reducible representation for each of those kinds of atomic orbitals. And we have our normal character assignment, right? If the molecular orbitals change position, or sorry, if the atomic orbitals change position, we assign that orbital a character of 0 for that symmetry operation. If they don't change, they get a character of 1. And if they stay put but they reverse their sign, then we give them a character of minus 1. Okay, this is exactly the same thing we've been doing. And then what we would do is we would find the irreducible representations of these outer orbitals. So for example, if we wanted to look at water, we'd be talking about looking at the hydrogens, right? We build up the reducible representation for the hydrogen 1s's, and then we'd reduce it to its irreducible components. This procedure is equivalent to giving what are called the group orbitals, okay? The orbitals of the outer atoms of a molecule. These are also called SALCs, okay? Symmetry-adapted linear combinations. So these are linear combinations of the atomic orbitals that have the correct symmetry to interact with the center atom of the molecule. Okay? So this is a nifty procedure to generate the SALCs of the molecule. And then what we want to do is we want to take the SALCs, the group orbitals, and we want to interact them using our symmetry considerations with the central atom of the molecule. And that will allow us to build up our molecular orbitals. Okay? So we find the atomic orbitals on the central atom for water, we're talking about oxygen, that have the same symmetry as the group orbitals. Then we interact the group orbitals with the center atom, and then we've got our molecular orbital diagram. Okay? And then we fill it up with the electrons that we've got in the molecule, and we are finished. So this full procedure can be followed for any of the examples that we're going to talk about, but for simple linear examples, we don't need to do the whole formal procedure. We can continue just to get the answer by inspection, okay, just by looking at the molecule and breaking it down into its parts and just thinking about it, we can derive the answer fairly rapidly. So we will leave the full procedure for molecules that are more difficult to understand just by inspection. Okay, so we have two examples where we're going to use inspection, and then we'll start using this full procedure. Let's look at our first triatomic example. And this is the simplest that you can possibly think of, I think. Linear H3+. Okay, it's an H3 ion. And it's the easiest, or one of the easiest, because we only have 1s orbitals to worry about. Right? And it's also linear, so it's quite nice. We're going to use the same flavor of procedure that I just described, but we're going to cut out a lot of the formal stuff. And we're just going to do it by looking at it. Let's first generate the group orbitals, and then we're going to mix them with the center atom. So what do I mean by doing that? So we take our H3, this is our linear H3+, and we break it into two parts mentally. We have our center atom, in this case we're going to call it a center ion, okay? And we have our group orbitals, or our outer atoms. Okay? So these are the outer atoms. Hydrogen separated by the place where the center hydrogen is, and then another hydrogen, the two outer hydrogens. And then we have our central atom that plops in the middle. That's this guy right in the middle here. Okay. So we're going to consider these two parts of the molecule separately, and then we're going to mix them together. That's the idea. So let's consider what our orbitals are going to be. Okay. The group orbitals, we have only 1s's on each hydrogen. And so the group orbitals have two different combinations, right? Just like a hydrogen molecule, we can have either the bonding or the anti-bonding combination. The difference here is that these hydrogens are so far apart that there's no overlap between these 1s orbitals. Okay? These are just, you can think of them as like separate, non-interacting 1s orbitals that just have both positive polarity or one positive and the other negative. There are no other possibilities for linear combinations of the atomic orbitals on the outer atoms. That's all there is to it. And for the central atom, we have a 1s, and we can choose it to be dark or light. It doesn't matter, right? It's totally arbitrary. Okay. And so those are the three atomic orbitals that we need to worry about. We have one central atom orbital. We have two group orbitals from the outer atoms. And now what we want to do is mix them. How do we mix them appropriately? We have to think about their symmetry. So this molecule here, right, is d infinity H. It has an inversion center in it. And so one way to look at the symmetry of these orbitals here is to determine whether they are ungarada or garada under inversion, right? Are they symmetric or antisymmetric with respect to inversion? So this guy here is definitely symmetric with respect to inversion. That's a G. This one here is symmetric with respect to inversion. That's also a G. But this one here is ungarada. It's antisymmetric with respect to inversion. If we invert, we multiply it by minus 1. So we can assign our labels, our symmetry labels. These are the ways that we can tell which are going to mix with which. And so we expect to have a bonding and an anti-bonding combination between the garadas, but nothing with the ungarada. It doesn't have a bonding partner on the central atom. So the U group orbital is just going to remain a non-bonding orbital. Okay. So let's put the molecular orbital diagram together. This is all we need to know to build the diagram. We expect the G orbitals are interacting and the U orbitals are not. We can put, this is going to be our convention, put the central atom on the left, put the group orbitals on the right, and then combine them. Okay? The central atom orbital and the group atom orbitals have the same energy. They're degenerate. That's because these hydrogens are sufficiently far apart that they don't feel each other, because there's that intervening hydrogen that sits in the middle, right? So there's no overlap between these 1s's. So they just have the energy of a 1s, right? There's two of them. That doesn't mean anything. They both have the energy of the 1s. Okay? And so when I write them like this, this doesn't mean that the ungarada is higher in energy than the grada. Look at the energies here. Okay? This is just so that I can write them. This means that they're degenerate, okay? And they're the same energy as this one. Now all we have to do is mix them appropriately. Okay? We have a G and we have a G, and so that's going to make a bonding and an antibonding pair. And we're going to have all the same shading for the bonding sigma orbital. Okay? And we're going to have positive, negative, positive for the antibonding, the sigma star orbital. So that takes care of this G and it takes care of this G. So all we have left is the U, and all it does is come straight across. It's non-bonding because it doesn't have a bonding partner on the central atom. Okay. How many electrons do we have? Well, it's H3 plus. So remember, this is H plus. It's got no electrons. So the two electrons are coming in from the outer atoms. And where do they sit? Well, they sit down there, right? One bond. This is quite an interesting concept now. If you look at this, these two electrons are shared between how many atoms?
Three.
So this is a so-called three-center two-electron bond. The electrons are delocalized over the entire three atoms. A very common and, in fact, dominant theme in molecular orbital theory is that you have electrons that are often delocalized over the entire molecule or significant parts of the molecule. Okay? So you can have two electrons that are bonding between five different atoms, for example. Okay? And how do we think about that? Well, we need to realize that the Lewis dot picture is just an oversimplification of nature. Right? So this is more correct to think of electron delocalization in this way. Questions about the H3 plus example? It does. Yep. It does. And so you can tell that it exists or predict that it should exist by looking at the bond order. Right? So it has a bond order of 1. That means it should have some sort of attractive interaction and some sort of stability. You can generate this in the gas phase, H3 plus. It's probably also, well, I'm sure it's extensively found in outer space, right? Including places like stars. OK. Any other questions? If not, we will end there and tackle our next example next time, which is this molecule, this ion, fluorine 2 hydrogen.